Last time on the show, we talked everything basketball with Paul Westhead. Before we show you part two of that interview, let's catch up with another all-time great coach, Rick Pitino, on his new post at Iona College.
Probably more excited today than any period of my life because it's a totally different experience, but it's back home. It's where I grew up. I spent a lot of time in Westchester when I was the New York Knicks coach. I lived in Almack and Bedford. And I'm probably more pumped up today than any time in the past because the one thing about Iona College, it's a small, charming little campus that every single coach that has coached here has had two things that really stick out from going back to Jim Valvano. Every coach has had great success, and every coach has moved on to greener pastures, so to speak, up the level of that ladder to a bigger conference. Well, I'm working in reverse. I'm ending my career at a place that for me is, it's all about teaching. It's all about being part of an academic community. And the people I've met here at the Iona College campus, and it's not many, to be honest with you, because of COVID, but people I've met, the alumni I've met, are so dedicated and loyal to Iona College that it's been a unique experience for me, and I'm very, very proud to be their head coach. The MAC is a group of coaches that can flat out coach the game. I know quite a few of them, and it just takes better scheduling and wins with better scheduling to get more than one team in the tournament. So I'm very honored to be the coach at Iona, to be part of the MAC, and certainly we're going to do everything possible to enhance the fortunes of the MAC conference.
Now, in the book, you mentioned that you actually kind of wrote this book twice. You wrote it at one point after or started to write it after that 1980 championship team and then picked it up, of course, much more recently and finished the book. You know, you speak of these great players that you had and Kareem Abdul-Jabbar and Magic Johnson in 1980. But your journey, as the book details, takes you through so many different walks of coaching the game. And that includes winning a championship with Diana Taurasi and the Phoenix Mercury in 2007. Talk a little bit about maybe having the greatest female player of all time on your roster.
Yeah, there's no question about that. If Kareem's close to Michael Jordan, Diana Taurasi on the women's side is Michael Jordan. I mean, she's clearly the best player that I ever coached on the women's side. And I think she'll go down in history as, you know, the number one player. She did everything. And she did something that no job I ever had did for me. When I arrived in Phoenix to sign the contract and start coaching, she met me at the airport. So can you imagine Kareem or Magic meeting me at the airport to say welcome, or Dikembe Mutombo in Denver saying, "Coach, how are you? Nice, you're here." But she met me, and on the ride, she said, "Treat us like the guys. Don't water anything down. We want to do your system as we think we know." And then a year later, we won a championship on the road in Detroit. I kind of reflected. I've only won two championships. Both have been on the road, and they were 28 years apart. So winning's not easy in this world.
You know, you speak of all these different coaching stops, too, which I think is still a good thing. I mean, to have this incredible journey where you've been able to affect people in the sport at so many different levels. I mean, you got a chance to coach in Japan. You coached the ABA, the WNBA, the NBA, the high school, the college game, and reaching, you know, the highest, basically the highest points in all of these different leagues. For you, has there been one particular stop that will always stand out? Because, again, the book really does a great job of detailing this incredible journey of your life.
Yeah, it's hard to pick one. It's like trying to pick your best player that you've coached. But certainly my years at Loyola Marymount University were the most memorable because that team put together my fast break speed game and full court defense that made the opposition run fast. And, you know, into my final season with them, we averaged 122 points a game, which, you know, it doesn't sound like a lot, but if you're going to average 122, that means you can't have many 94 games. You know, 122 is a hard average to get to and keep. So that probably is the single most coaching experience that, you know, I will remember. The team at Loyola Marymount with Hank and Bo, and obviously mixed in a great sadness and grief with the enjoyment of the team.
Paul, why do you love coaching so much?
Yeah, well, it kind of gave me a lot of incentive to prove what I thought was a good system. I mean, I think coaching is a good career, but when you have a specific style, when you have a specific approach, and you want to do it, prove it, show it, it gives you more juice to go every day and say, okay, finally, I found a team that wants to run. Because I found a lot of teams that 10 days into being their coach, they didn't want to run. It was over. So the sadness of getting fired kind of adds to the incentive to finally get it right. And in with the Lakers a little bit, with LMU to the max, and to the Phoenix Mercury with Diana Taurasi to the max, they were a good, very good running team.
You know, your style of play clearly at that time might not have been fully embraced by all these different levels, but I think you can make a case that your innovativeness has really translated to the modern NBA game, because so many teams nowadays really want to get out and run, and they want to shoot from the outside like Bo Kimble did.
Well, for sure, you're correct on the outside part. I mean, the game has evolved that outside shooting is at the highest priority in basketball. In my system, we had a couple spots like our two spot where Jeff Fryer played and made 11 threes in the NCAA tournament against Michigan and still holds that record. And I see more and more outside shooting. The Lakers, Anthony Davis is shooting, you know, 25, 30 footers, and he's a, you know, 6'11", 7 foot center. So, yes, but the actual speed game, Bobby, the run fast on any continual basis really isn't going on. You know, basketball is more of a control game, more a tempo game, and players do not want to run fast. You see, that's always been my challenge. I have teams, and they say they want to run fast, and 10 days later, they want to run slow. Coach, we had enough of this. So, but the modern game has picked up on the outside shooting for sure.
So definitely up tempo, but not up tempo on every single possession.
Yeah, not speed game tempo.
Yeah, of course. You know, for those that, again, hopefully our fans that are new to you that might not have been old enough to watch some of these great teams that you had. You know, what would be, I would love to ask you this question. It is something I do ask a lot of the times when we have authors on the show. You know, what would be the message that you would want to send to those at home as to a good reason why they should pick up the book?
Well, I think you'll read a story of a person who had a scheme and stuck with it and was knocked down a number of times, but on some occasions was successful. And maybe that's it was not meant to be a life lesson, but maybe there are some life lessons that you're going to get knocked down a lot, and it's worth the times that you don't get knocked down and you pull it off. But I just wanted the people to know that my system is not for everybody, but it was for me.
Yeah, Paul, I mean, your offense knocked their socks off, and your book does as well.
Thank you, Bobby. Yeah.
Thank you so much for taking the time to tell us a little bit about it this morning.
It's my pleasure. Thank you.